Say a big thank you to Tom and Pops and all of you that bought our album and making it platinum. We also want to say thank you to God, and we'll see you later on the show. Bye.
Eternal's Kelly Bryan there with a really awful transatlantic accent. But anyway, it's Top of the Pops.
This is Top of the Pops, and here on China.
Bruno Brooks is your host, and I've not got my notes out to see what date this is. But China Black are at number four with Searching on this episode dated August the 18th, 1994. So, yeah, China Black, I remember this. I was 14 years old when this episode was first transmitted on presumably BBC One, unless it was temporarily shifted over to BBC Two. We didn't have anything like BBC Three, BBC Four, CBeebies back then. By the way, kids. So, China Black, I remember this. This was a big hit. I think probably one of the biggest hits of the year. I don't think it was a number one, though. So yeah, Searching, I can't really say a lot about China Black, I can't really say anything about them. I think it's a group. I don't think it's just the lead singer guy. Could be. As always, there's some information going along the ticker bar there on the bottom left. But I remember this very well. Was never a massive fan of the song, but it's one of those that you kind of heard, you know, on the radio at breakfast time or in the car. You heard it in the background on television programs like EastEnders, Coronation Street, whatever. And it wasn't offensive, it was pleasant enough. Just not the sort of thing, not the sort of music that I would actively listen to and actively go out and purchase. But a fine start to my first episode that I've reacted to of Top of the Pops in 1994. So welcome to another reaction or another commentary. As I mentioned in last month, the end of July episode, it was 1982 or something like that, where generally I'm going to be doing these one a month now, just so that I don't burn through too many good quality editions of TOTP. But there might be the odd month where I decide to do two, because maybe there'll be just a lot to choose from in a certain month, or I might be unable to decide what I want to watch, so I'll just do both. So as far as August this month is concerned, this is the only one I'm intending to do. So chances are, if you tune into this channel just to see these, and I know these are quite popular views-wise compared to some other videos, then it will probably be September when the next one will be in. But there we go, China Black, that was fine.
China Black, if you're searching for the best songs and more than a splash of colour, you have found it.
Oh, this is our next. Excellent.
Palm tree in sight, a very strong message, live forever.
Doesn't really need an introduction from me, does it? Live Forever by Oasis. This would have been their third single, taken from the debut album Definitely Maybe, of course. It has gone down as one of the all-time greatest debut albums, and I think it's a lot of people's favourite Oasis album of all, really. Me personally, I think What's the Story Morning Glory is a little bit stronger. And I didn't actually mind Being Here Now either, but there was some iconic singles from Definitely Maybe. This one, obviously, is probably the first one that springs to mind for a lot of people. And then after this would have been Cigarettes and Alcohol. What number was this at? Number 10. Does it get much higher? I don't think it does, actually. This might be its peak position. I know this is their first top 10 single, because I'm pretty sure the first two, Supersonic and Shaker Maker, Supersonic was like number 30 something, Shaker Maker might have made the top 20. Any interesting information regarding Oasis and chart positions, because I'm a bit of a nerd when it comes to the charts, I'll put in the ticker bar. 1994 then. Interesting year, really. I think the grunge explosion was probably dying down. That's probably not the most tactful way of putting it, given I think it was 94, the year Kurt Cobain committed suicide. But obviously, with the fine example being Oasis here themselves, Britpop was on the rise. You could argue Britpop's peak would have been the following year with the so-called battle of Britpop, Blur versus Oasis, and Country House versus Roll With It. And Oasis got into doing like funny miming on Top of the Pops at this stage. We know sort of certainly around the Morning Glory era they would just muck around on stage and Noel would mime Liam's bits and vice versa. But this performance, if you can call it a performance, it's lip syncing and everything. It seems to be taking it relatively seriously. Liam Gallagher there. His microphone almost up his nose. Not the only thing he was putting up his nose a lot in those days. Alright. Well, very happy with this episode so far. China Black was fine for what it was, but Oasis, Live Forever, great single. Enjoyed that.
Coming up later on, we've got a turtle for you, Soundgarden, also Houston Dura and Dana Cherry, via satellite from New York and New Orleans. It's all happening on Top of the Pops. Here comes Tin Man.
Tin Man. So, got a video here, Tin Man 18 Strings, a former club number one, apparently. Oh, I don't really remember this, weirdly. Although it does sound familiar. Oh, we get a chart rundown as well. I'll have a look at this, see if there's anything interesting to talk about. But I'm enjoying Tin Man and 18 Strings. I like the guitar riff that it's sampling. Is it sampling Nirvana, maybe? Probably not. Enigma there, new entry at 34. Well, this was quite commonplace, seeing the top 40 shown during a promo video by this point. I'm really enjoying this, Tin Man. Yeah, this is great. I'm enjoying this more than Oasis, but this is my sort of thing. Like a good dance track, and it's got some sort of rock elements to it. A nice kind of mashup of genres, if you will. Morrissey and Susie there at number 25. Some big names in this chart. How many of these will end up seeing? Sophie B. Hawkins, right beside you, remember that? That was a pretty good single. Aswad, down at 20. Great Swamp Thing, I remember that. There's Eternal. You'd imagine we'll be seeing Eternal later, seeing as how they open the show. And Kelly Bryan. Did I call her Kelly Rowland earlier on? If I did, I apologise. She's from Destiny's Child. But Kelly Bryan, she's an actress now on Hollyoaks, and you know her normal voice is nothing like a sort of weird quasi-American accent that she was doing there. But, who knows why people do what they do? Really like that. Nothing I actually remembered. I thought, I'm going to remember a lot of the stuff on this chart. 1994, I was listening to a lot of music. So speak of the Devils. This is So Good by Eternal. I think there was a new entry, it said, rather than a climber at number 18. I can't remember if I have reacted to an Eternal performance before. I don't think so. I know there was an episode of Top of the Pops from 1995 and they were hosting it. It was a really good episode that had Wild Hearts on it, Entrance, a couple other really good things as well. What do I think of this? A bit like China Black, really. Inoffensive, but I wouldn't go out of my way and listen to this. I wouldn't have gone out of my way to listen to Eternal full stop back then. I think when Louise Nerding, or Louise Redknapp as she would become, when she left, it probably was at some point in 95 actually, probably not long after their edition of Top of the Pops that they hosted, the one that I reacted to. Really good episode if you've not seen it. Go back into my playlist and the Top of the Pops reaction playlist and you'll find it. And all my others that I've done. This series has been going on now for almost 2 years, I think. This is not doing anything for me. Unfortunately, I can't remember the other two's names in Eternal. I'll have put them on screen, I'm sure I will. But Kelly Bryan, who was my favourite in terms of, you know, how she looked, attractiveness. Like I say, she's now an actor. And Louise Redknapp, where everyone, oh bloody hell, I think 90% of the boys at school fancied her. And yeah, she's not awful, she's not exactly a chocolate ice or anything, but I just found her a bit kind of vanilla. She's not doing much for me. Of course, the rumours about Eternal were Louise got forced out of the group because their management or their record label claimed that they wouldn't sell in America if it was three black women and one white. Now, how true that is, I don't know, but that is something I've read. That's the theory, the conspiracy theory. Oh, well, a bit of a grunge hangover here. Because we've got Black Hole Sun from Soundgarden. I remember this. It was quite a popular single at school. I remember not so much my friends, but sort of, you know, lads I was in class with. They talked about rags like Nirvana and Soundgarden. Pearl Jam were popular in the schoolyard at this point. And all the girls liked all the teeny bopper stuff at this point. Take That, E17, Let Loose, possibly. all the lads seemed to like Nirvana and Soundgarden, Stone Temple Pilots, Pearl Jam, Bon Jovi, although you can't put Bon Jovi in with all that. But Bon Jovi was, I don't know. I've never rated Bon Jovi massively. They're, you know, a boy band with extra hair and a couple of guitars, really, for me, Bon Jovi. But, you know, I've offended people with my opinions about Bon Jovi before. Anyway, let's concentrate on Soundgarden. So, presumably that'll be, what was his name, Chris Connell, is it? If I'm getting his name wrong, I apologise. Sadly now passed away. I enjoyed his Bond theme that he did. He did the Bond theme, I think, with Alicia Keys for... I should know. It's either Casino Royale or Quantum of Solace, and I can't remember which one it is. It's definitely not Skyfall, because Adele did the theme for Skyfall. But, yeah, Chris Connell, I think, the Soundgarden singer's name. They're not a band that I've ever really listened to. This is probably the only one of theirs that I know quite well, and it's alright. Not my cup of tea, really, but an improvement on Eternal and China Black, but still not really in my wheelhouse, this. But, so I've got had a nice mixture of stuff, you know. We had a Britpop, we've had some grunge, we've had some R&B with Eternal and China Black, and we've had a brilliant dance track, my highlight so far, with Tin Man, whoever he or she might be. Assuming it's a he. Or it could be more than one. Anyway, look. Okay. Weird kind of walkie-talkie sort of link there. I don't know why they did that, but it's a song I remember well. It's a nice song, this. I would have thought it gets a little higher than number 8, but this is 7 seconds, using the door. Oh God, I'm going to try and remember what country it's from. It's an African country, Ghana, maybe. And there's, of course, Naina Cherry. Massive worldwide hit, this. I think this was the only really big hit using the door had in the UK, but it would have sold a lot of stuff. Probably a lot of francophone countries, and certainly in his own continent of Africa as well. It's like obviously a crossover and it's an exposure to his brand of African pop here in the West. Yeah, I've always liked Naina Cherry. And I always liked this song. Never loved it as I thought, oh wow, I love this track so much, I'm going to listen to it all the time. But whenever I heard it, or saw the video somewhere, I would happily, you know, sit and watch it, listen to it. See, I'm trying to... It seems like he's singing in French, but I don't know. It's weird, isn't it, how you can enjoy someone singing and not really understand the word. I mean, I have a lot of experience with that. I've been a fan of Rammstein now for, you know, getting on for 15 years. And... although you just kind of pick words up and you learn sort of the odd one or two, but even after 15 years or more listening to Rammstein, I don't really understand a lot of what's being said, what's being sang by Till Lindemann. But you still enjoy it. And that's a testament to the power of music, really, that... it doesn't matter what language it's in. If someone's giving a performance that's powerful, that resonates with you somehow, it doesn't matter if you don't understand the words. That's definitely English. Me and voices. It was a bit of a mid-90s meme. We didn't have memes in the mid-90s, but... yeah, a lot of kids sort of like to sing me and voices at each other, because that was, you know, a memorable bit of the song. This is what we did before the internet, don't judge us.
Looks much like hard work. Another USA exclusive coming up. Meanwhile, Sophie B. Hawkins right beside you.
Oh, okay. You know what? I think this has been a really good episode. Sophie B. Hawkins now at number 22. Now, was she kind of a one-hit wonder? She hasn't really done anything since, I don't think. Nothing I can think of, anyway. But this was another big hit. You'd hear this a lot on TV. Often played in heavy rotation on the radio. And I like this. I think this is a good track. You know, good, simple pop song with a really good chorus. Sounds like something that there was probably some good remixes that came out for this, which I was never exposed to, sadly. This was a funny time, really. I was listening to quite a bit of music, but I wasn't collecting a lot. It would have been still a year and a bit before I even had my first CD player bought for me. And then once I'd got my CD player at Christmas 95, that was when I just started collecting music, like, massively, like, mostly singles, but... a lot of albums for favourite artists of mine, you know, New Order. I've made sure I started collecting them, you know, 95, 96, Beatles, Pet Shop Boys. They were another one I collected on CD quite early. But yeah, I really like this. This is another personal highlight for me. Right, I've not heard this song in years as well, and it's not dated. This is the sort of thing... This sounds like it could be in the chart now. Well, I say could be in the chart now. There's just weird shit in the chart now, isn't it? Like all this mumble rap and stuff, which I thought some of it's alright, but most of it I couldn't give a tuppenny fart for. Oh, I forgot there's this weird talky bit in it. Yeah, so I haven't really talked a lot about many of the artists tonight. China Black I know nothing about, and Sophie B. Hawkins, I'd love to be able to sit and tell you what she's been up to, but I'm going to have to look that up myself and give you all the info in the old bar. But what a great pop song this is. So far, and this is some, you know, even above Oasis, I would say it's my favourite track on this episode so far. It's a toss-up between this and Tin Man. It might even be this, actually, with this being a studio performance. And just, I really enjoyed hearing that for all these years.
The next harmonious group have sold over 8 million copies of their album in the USA, and their new single is number 2 in the States this week. Would you welcome to Top of the Pops the fabulous Boyz II Men? I'll make love to you.
Oh, all right. Doesn't look like this is a chart performance. Yes, it's an exclusive, so it's coming out as a single, probably out that week, I expect. Yeah, I'd never liked this when I was a teenager. Yeah, not. I mean, I can sort of sit here now and, you know, appreciate. Yeah, they've got good voices. Well, I've not heard the rest of them, but he's got a good voice. You know, this whoever this lead singer is. Now, this isn't a high point for me of this edition. But Boyz II Men, four-piece R&B soul vocal act, obviously. Massive in America. Pretty big over here as well. This might have got to number one over here. I'm not certain. Did they have any number ones? Yeah, they must have had a number one of some description over here. Kind of a nice symmetry with Eternal there, where they were all dressed in white suits, and now Boyz II Men are. Well, is it white or cream? I don't know. It's not the worst single that's ever come out. I don't hate it. I think 20, how many years ago was this now? 28, oh God, I feel so old. I'm sure I would have hated it back when I was 14 years old. But now it's just, you know, it is what it is. This sort of shit was popular, weren't it? And it cost probably a lot of age ranges as well. It sounds like the sort of thing your mum would enjoy, but then again, your younger sister would as well. I'm not got anything to say about this apart from I don't like it. I don't hate it. I don't think it's absolutely awful, like maybe what I used to. But I don't know, I can appreciate their vocal abilities, but that's about as far as it goes.
Boyz II Men, yeah. And I'll make love to you. Okay, let's now look at this week's.
All right, we've got a top 10.
At number 10, a new entry for Oasis. You saw them earlier with Live Forever. 9, BC52's Meet the Flintstones. At 8, also earlier via satellite, Usandora
good
Nina
song.
Cherry. At 7,
oh,
G,
great
Mick
song.
Regulus.
Oh, brilliant. Warren G, Regulate.
And at number 6, a sweet DJ Miko with What's Up.
Oh, I don't
up.
Remember that.
At 5, Red Dragon with Brian and Tony.
I don't remember that either.
And earlier in the show, China Black and Searching at 4. Right.
Number three, oh, I hated that. I know I hated that. It was awful, that. This week's two, let you lose. I know what's at number one now. Yeah. Twelve weeks at number one. And they would have another Shed 7, Dinosaur Jr., Ice Cube, Chaka, Demon Supplies, CNC Music Factory. So that's essentially some of the new entries that will be in the next top 40, which would follow on Radio 1 at their 12th week at number 1.
The unlucky 13. Check us out on the top 40 Sunday at 4 o'clock only on 1FM. The legendary Malcolm McLaren will be presenting the show next week.
Look, Malcolm McLaren presenting the show next week. So we've got the end credits now, so sounding like it's playing over Aswad, perhaps, maybe, I don't know. But this is where I say goodbye. Thank you all for watching. Join me next month for my next Top of the Pops reaction. It's going to be a good one, I've no doubt about that. Join me for it. Cheers, everyone. See ya!